Hello. We are Unbrightly, and we find humans on the internet. Because online advertising is basically this machine that you pour money into, and you hope that the conversions are going to come. And you optimize, and you test, and you improve your site. And you do that again and again until your conversion rate improves. And the problem with that is, it's a fairly expensive but working process. You're optimizing thinking that you're getting this. 10 humans if you buy 10 visits. But whatever you use for tracking is not telling you that the truth looks like this. 3 robots out of 10 visitors. The internet advertising bureau has shown that from every 10 click, 3 or more will not be made by a human being in online advertising. Let that sink in for a minute. That's huge. Online advertising is a $121 billion yearly business. And a third of it is fraud. It's bots. This affects everyone, not just businesses losing a lot of money, but if you ever had a person call you and asking for technical help because their computer is slow, they got a virus, it's because the computer in the background is running Internet Explorer and clicking on advertisements. So companies are sponsoring viruses through this ecosystem. And we at Unbrightly will not have that. We believe in transparency. So we have built a system, a software as a service, that you plug into your advertisements or your website. It tracks your traffic, the behavior of your visitors. It analyzes their behavior and segments them into humans or bots by checking for patterns. All of this is then used to make profiles out of your traffic sources, giving you the necessary information on what sort of traffic you're getting. It also alerts you before you issue a payout about fraud, saving you money in the process. And all of this you get through a simple to use user interface, which we charge for based on the amount of visitors we analyze every month. Now, obviously, this is a huge scandal. Advertising is in trouble. So now we know that the old school methods of fighting advertising fraud are not enough anymore. Pattern recognition is the name of the new game. So we are competing with companies such as WhiteOps, Telemetry, and Spider.io, which was bought by Google earlier this year, which is kind of admitting that there is a problem in the ecosystem, to restore trust in advertising. Our team has experience in this. We know the problem deeply. We have operated an Alexa Top 25 website where we did everything from transactions to marketing and risk management. So we realized that the tools that we should use to fight fraud are not available. We had to develop a lot of things in-house, and that's where the idea of Unbrightly was born. So we've added in big data and predictive analysis into that mix to build what we have. And this team was able to take a drawing on a piece of paper in 6 months to a product that is saving our first paying customer 30% of their advertising budget a month. We are onboarding the second customer, and we are talking with advertising networks directly because we plan to scale by addressing the problem head on. Advertising networks have the inventory. They're the first ones affected by fraud. Furthermore, we are going to automate the sales process because every advertiser will need a tool to check for fraud. And we plan to do it in a simple way that you can use our tool as you can use Google Analytics. You sign up, you copy the code, paste it to your site, pay the bill, and you protect it. To do this, we are looking for €500,000 in funding, which would cover development, infrastructure costs, and HR costs or costs. And we will also be pumping money into the marketing machine, but you can bet that we will be checking our own traffic. So that was it. Thank you. We are Unbrightly. We find humans on the internet, and you can help us restore trust in online advertising. And I'll have your questions.
Very nice job. Can you talk a little bit more about what your first customer found in terms of increasing their lift, and where do you hope that ultimately lands?
So, the first customer has an in-house affiliate program. They basically pay for a lot of clicks, and they let almost anyone in the ecosystem, once they do their due diligence. And we proved that like 30% of the traffic they're getting is generated by click bots. So they cut out those partners, which saved them a lot of money. So they can use that to buy more traffic from sources that they actually trust.
Who do you hurt in this process? Obviously, the click bots and the people sponsoring that, but I would assume that publishers or ad networks, intellectually like the idea of reducing this problem, but they actually get paid when it happens.
Yeah, what we've been getting is a lot of people would love to know how much bad traffic they're getting, how much good traffic they're getting, and they would still like to sell both. So they don't want like a system that will shut down the bots, but a system that tells them which one are the bots so they know what they're reselling.
But as they identify that, what do they do with the information? I'm just trying to understand if they ultimately are your friend or a challenge to your business.
It really depends on how shady they do their business, but a lot of them are friendly in a way. So they either use it to like cut out the payments, like in, for example, in affiliate programs, or they send in proof to their advertisers saying, okay, I'm not paying for this traffic, because if you look at the behavior, it's obviously a bunch of bots. And some people will be, well, we don't really care, as long as we make money, bots are not a problem. I've also heard that, so yeah.
Yep. Thanks a lot for the presentation. Great stuff from Startup Sona, so I'm proud of you. What about getting into the market? Would you go for the DSPs or the ad networks, or which way do you like to go?
Right now, we are going to go to the ad networks and the real-time bidding networks because they have the most fraud and the least time to check for it. Because money comes in, they pay it out to the publishers almost instantly. So by human analysis, it's near impossible to uncover fraud in that time frame. But with a tool like this, they immediately know if there's a problem in the system and they can act upon it. So that's like that leaves a couple of hundred massive companies who we can approach directly. And if the market matures enough that advertisers will also be demanding a solution like this, then we can scale massively through them.
Can you say just a little bit more about how you're going to charge? Just talk about your revenue model a bit more.
Mm-hmm. So we charge based on the amount of visitors analyzed. We try to came up with a model where the customer never ends up paying more than half of what we save. Pretty often it's even less than that. So because this is like a high infrastructure cost industry to be in, basically we pre-sell them the volume. So if they need 200 million clicks analyzed, then we're going to say, okay, give us $1,000 for that. We're working on the exact numbers right now. And they can buy it in bulk. So for like 6 months in advance, they'll have everything analyzed. And when they run out of credit, so to speak, they can top up the account. And then they're covered for 6 more months or something.
Mandatory technical question. Mm-hmm. In 6 months, you've been coding something that detects how the bots work today. How much of the manual work you have in the background when you start to get bigger? Than, is it the cat and mouse every day that you're chasing the robots or the behaviors? Or how does it work?
I've had this question before. It's security is basically building taller walls, and then they use taller ladders. So it's like a never-ending arms race. But if you think of, for example, McAfee antivirus, I think they're pretty fine off. Also, so the problem is so big right now that if you have a competitive solution to solve it, then it's going to take the fraudsters a couple of years to catch up, but then you've made enough business to research the next tool.
How accurate is your prediction engine, and how do you know if you're right or not?
I would say 98% right now, and the more data we get, the more the system can learn. A lot of stuff is pre-built in what sort of clickbots we've seen before. So that's the patterns it checks for. And then we also do manual analysis to teach the system in a way, because some websites pop up, they're fishy, our numbers show it's kind of edgy. So we have to find out what's the exact method of fraud, and then we can build that into the system. But we're pretty fast on that because like the low-level footwork fraud is covered completely, so we can spend that time analyzing the high-level.
The question on pricing that came up, I don't quite follow the answer you gave, because you said on the one hand, you don't think you should exceed 50% of your savings, which feels to me like a really high price to put it at. But then the example you gave, and maybe the numbers weren't what you meant, you said you'd charge $1,000 to cover 200 million clicks, which is certainly less than 50% of anything.
Yeah,
where do you look at pricing?
We have to build the pricing based on volume because our infrastructure takes out on volume as well. And we're checking like every tidbit of user behavior. So it's not just like per page view. unfortunately. And this pricing model is what we found, especially by applying a prepaid model instead of a subscription, that maximizes customer lock-in, because they buy, for example, 20 million clicks to analyze. Say they have 100 million in traffic a month. So that's going to cover them for the first quarter of the month. But still, they will see all the fraud and all the problems, and they will feel that they need to use the product, because if they stop using the product, there's no more information flowing in. Did that answer the question? No, not quite.
No, it didn't.
I'm sorry.
Just use that example. 100 million clicks a month. What would you charge them?
We charge a pilot customer for 80 million clicks a month around $3,000.
Thank you.
And what's the production cost, if you like? How much do you have to put on the infrastructure? And
80 million clicks is costing us less than $1,000, if well optimized.
So sales margin about 70-65%?
Yeah, you could say that. Not counting customer acquisition costs, of course.
So what's the biggest challenge you have to go through, other than raising the money, over the next 6 months?
It's educating the market. We've ran into a lot of blind alleys, because for a while we were stumbling around a bit in not realizing that we have to go to the people whose core business relies on paying and selling traffic. They feel the problem immediately. Other times we had to literally tell people on yes, have you heard about clickbots? Did you know that this is affecting you? And that's a long process. It makes the sales process really long. And that was a dead end. So that's why we're going back to the ad networks and generally, or pre-educated customers, let me say, because otherwise we need to do a lot of effort on teaching them why they need this.
Yeah. Let's say that I'm the owner of an ad network and I'm already using white ops, then what's the difference? Enterprise is cheaper or better or? Yeah.
No, ours at this stage were a bit more customizable to customer needs. And white ops also has this pre-box solution. But at this stage, we are integrating directly through APIs into different systems. So ours could be used, for example, to build up an ad network where you reject showing an ad, not just get fraud reports at this point. That's an advantage that comes from our size, I guess.
Well done. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Hi. Software is eating the world, and learning how to code is becoming mainstream. Developers, on average, actually spend more than 25% of their time not writing code, but getting their code to work. For people who are just starting out, the time takes even longer. Hi, my name is Wei Ting. I'm the founder of Codementor. Codementor is a marketplace that provides on-demand support and training for software development. We're making it easy for developers to get connected with expert mentors on demand via screen sharing, videos, and chat. We're going after a huge market opportunity. We've had great traction so far, and we have the right team to make this happen. So Codementor is a two-sided marketplace. Developers can come to our site and sign up and apply to become a mentor. Once they pass through our vetting and approval process, they're welcome to set their own rate in 15-minute increments. Our business model works such that we make money by asking for a small transaction fee for each transaction. On the demand side, there are two ways you can get help. There's on-demand live support, and there's the long-term mentorship. So if you want to launch your own iPhone app in the next 3 months, you can come to Codementor and work with someone regularly on a monthly retainer fee, as if you have a personal trainer for software development. Let me give you a quick demo on how this works.
the video does not work again. So use your imagination a little bit. So say if you have a Ruby on Rails request right now, you can go to Codementor and post your request on Codementor. You'll see a list of online mentors who are online, and you can instantly get connected to someone in an online session room. There's video chat, there's audio chat, and there's text chat. There's even a code snippet, code pad, where you can collaborate on a code snippet. There's also screen sharing, so you can do remote pair programming with a mentor live remotely across multiple continents. The mentor can also have access to your machine and make edits directly in your code while verbally conveying what's going on. At the end of the session, you can also leave a review and rating for the mentor. So just like Airbnb, just like eBay, Codementor is a marketplace with a reputation system built in. So since launching in March of this year, we've been growing at 30% month over month. We now have close to 2,000 vetted expert mentors, including O'Reilly book authors, creators of some of the most popular open source libraries out there, and also engineers at top tech companies such as Google and Amazon. On the demand side, we have close to 20,000 developers in our community. And just so you're wondering, Codementor is not just for beginners. We have plenty of developers in both startups and large enterprises use Codementor to become much more productive because they can do pair programming and code reviews with domain experts and learn the latest emerging technologies. As for the team, we have an awesome team with a proven track record. I am both a YC and a TechStars alum. I'm a serial entrepreneur, and I grew my last company from 2 to 50 people in 18 months in Taiwan with my brother. We now have a team of 8 people in the Silicon Valley and Taiwan. I also have the privilege to count some of the most prominent investors in the marketplace industry as our backers, including Brad Feld, David Cohen, Fabrice Grinda, Rolf Matisse, and TechStars. They're working closely with us to help us build a successful and liquid marketplace. So to recap, we are Codementor. We are a live-held marketplace for developers. We're going after a huge market. We have awesome traction, and we have a great team to make this happen. Thank you.
Hi, great presentation. Tell me a little bit more about the mentors. Who are they and why are they doing it? It's probably not for the just for the $25 an hour or whatever they're getting paid, right?
Right. Yeah, so there are two primary drivers. One, it is definitely possible for someone to make a significant amount of money right now. So we pay the quite a few mentors thousands of dollars per month for this. And they're definitely not working full time for this. And there's actually quite a few mentors who are willing to do this for free. So developers naturally enjoy helping each other out, and it's just a very enjoyable experience for them. I would say that half of the mentors on our site are freelancers. Half of them have full-time jobs already. We have engineers working full-time at tech companies. They're already making six figures. So in some way, they're charging money as a symbolic filter, so because they don't want to have computer science students ask them to do homework for them, for example.
Okay, so yeah, which is better, Y Combinator or TechStars?
I'm sorry?
I don't want you to
answer that. That was a trick question.
I don't want you to answer that, yeah. Interesting pricing model. I wanted you to just talk a little bit about how much people are spending. I mean, you're up and running now and you're growing at 30%. I mean, what's the potential scale here? How much can someone earn being a mentor, and how much might someone spend? And just kind of talk
right.
me through how.
As of right now, most of our paying users are still mainly individuals, but we're starting to see, similar to how GitHub did in the early stages, we have individual developers starting to bring Codementor into their companies. So we're starting to see individual developers within large organizations using Codementor and ask their company to expense for this. So we believe this can have the potential to be a multi-billion market.
the IT service industry is already 15 billion, and we believe as software is leading the world, not all tech, like every company, not just tech companies, are going to have to work with technologies. But not everyone is Google, not everyone is Facebook, so not everyone can afford to hire the rock stars full time. Well, it just happens that we do have full time, well, we do have rock star experts who will be able to help you out on demand. So you might not be able to hire them for 40 hours a week, but you might be able to hire them for 1 hour a month.
And is that legal? Can you work at Amazon and then go work on the side for somebody else?
I suppose. Yes.
That's it. Let's say yes. Okay. So how is the satisfaction? What's the satisfaction level like? And what's the retention like? So if I'm what kind of statistics can you give us about?
Yeah, so for any given month, I think last month, the 70% of their sessions have been made by repeat users. And we have a strong word of mouth going on, so 70% of our sessions are made by users coming from organic traffic, word of mouth, SEO. We've done a great tremendous job of SEO. Yes.
And just, I don't remember that you answered how much someone might make, and what are you kind of, what are the top earners making, for example?
A few thousand dollars per month.
Okay, so that's what you mentioned before. And then, and how many clients would that represent? Does it take like 10 people to generate 3,000, 10 people who want mentoring?
Right.
What's the ratio? What's your average revenue per
I would say, yeah, 10. Sounds like the right ballpark. We do have a lot of users who've paid thousands of dollars on our site already.
So I have a few questions that are probably fairly quick to answer, and then one more. What do you do with the money? How much do you need, and what are your revenues right now?
We have plenty of money in the bank. We're not actively looking to raise money before this, although you'll be tremendously awesome to work with great guys again. We are close to be cash flow positive soon. So if everything goes well, we will not be in the need to raise money ever again.
And if you win this, everyone else who's running is going to be really mad. How big is this market? And it's obviously a rapidly evolving market, but it feels to me like there's lots of different players in it. Certainly learning code is something that is being promoted through all sorts of channels around the world as
right.
a way of moving people forward. How big do you view it being? You mentioned 15 billion broadly for the IT market. What do you think is addressable for what you're doing?
This is definitely a very nascent market. I mean, this getting help for coding help online, this user behavior is totally new. Like, this really does not exist, well, a year or 2 years ago. There's a lot of, I wouldn't say compares, but similar companies in adjacent market spaces, right? So learning how to code, you would think about you go to Codecademy to get free interactive training. You go to, if one step down would be the treehouse and code schools of the world, where you pay $25, $50 a month to watch video tutorials. Then you would need to work with Codementor. So it's almost like an online, one-on-one programming tutor of the world. So we think that as we grow, as the learning how to code wave is continuing to grow, it's going to become mainstream, we'll be a very significant player in this industry.
One more quick question. Is your brother in the business with you?
I'm sorry?
Is your brother in the business with you?
No, he's not.
Okay.
Where are the boundaries for the Codementor? You are like the UI UX design, database designs, or is it just pure code?
Definitely including database and essentially anything to do with technologies, even including UI UX and design. So. Our natural next step for expansion, it's actually on our roadmap, is to expand to other verticals such as design. And this is already happening organically. We have users of Codementor who are designers themselves, and just say, hey, Weiting, I would love to become a design mentor once you go to that vertical. And we're starting to see quite a few developers who, in addition to need code help, they love to, hey, I would like to have some design help as well.
Thank you. Waiting for the excellent presentation. It's just what is your kind of a daily problem? You have now customers coming in, you have a lot of cash. Like, what is the problem?
Yeah, we're building a two-sided marketplace. Mm-hmm. That's like throwing a knuckleball in the baseball analogy, right? Mm-hmm. It is tremendously hard. It's all about reaching and maintaining the liquidity of the two-sided marketplace. Mm-hmm. For us, it's even more challenging.
I'm sorry? How are you doing it?
We're managing well, thanks to a lot of people's support. Like, unlike something like eBay, there's also this real-time aspect to this. Mm-hmm. And there's multiple categories in all those different technologies, right? So we have built a pretty robust internal analytics tool for us to monitor our liquidity across various different metrics.
Mm-hmm. And again, about the market size, just you know, how should I understand the market size?
Yeah, if you believe the following few trends are going to happen, you're going to believe there's going to be a multi-billion dollar market company in this market. The learning how to code trend, and if you believe that education is moving to online, the Courseras of the world, the Udacities of the world, that's like phase one of online education. The biggest problem that they have right now is, well, people sign up for course, but very few people really finish because they got into problems, and they got stuck, and they will bounce. So if there's going to be a layer of online tutoring for technologies, for all of those advanced skills, that will be us.
Last question. You have a two-sided marketplace. Liquidity is an issue. What's the most important side, the supply side or the demand side?
We've reached the stage that it's all about driving demand right now. Getting quality suppliers traditionally hasn't been a challenge relatively for us. So it's all about driving demand for us.
Great. Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you.
We all shop online. It's quite funny that out of those millions of products that there is available in e-commerce, there is only one type of packaging. It's the one that you always throw away after use. I'm Jonne, I'm a leader of Repack, and we are going to remove packaging trash from e-commerce. This all started with the project we did as a sustainable design company with Finnish Post Office. We spent a lot of time in logistics centers in Finland, and we saw all this, the rise of e-commerce, really. The market is growing by over 20%. And all the packaging, yeah, as I said, it's being thrown away. Currently in Europe, almost 4 billion annually. So one of our innovators, Juha, he's here in the audience. He was in Copenhagen in the 1990s, and he was quite impressed by the bottling return system there, where with three empty beer bottles, he could get a new full beer. So he sensed that there is value in deposits. So he came up with an idea that maybe we could do a reusable packaging for e-commerce, somewhere where the value of deposit is actually something that you can feel. So Juha kept talking to us for a couple of months, trying to convince us with the idea. And finally, we got it. So the idea is that in e-commerce, really, the packaging is the one that really stays with you. And do web stores really want to leave a feeling of trash to their customers? I don't think so. So we created Repack, it's a reusable delivery packaging. We started with fashion companies, and the idea is that it improves consumer loyalty. It brings new sales, and there is no trash. It saves money to the customers as well. And this is how it works, really. If you go to, for example, Globehope, one of our customers, you pay a small fee, €3, for Repack deposit. The package is delivered in a reusable packaging, and you can return this to any letterbox in Europe, free of charge. When we get this back, we will reward you with a voucher that you can use at any Repack using store, saving you money bringing in new sales to the web stores. We started out working with fashion. We also have packaging for furniture and for electronics. So the idea of Repack is really in the reuse. We don't sell packaging. It's only being used by the companies that use it. And this same model can be applied to different segments, such as furniture and electronics. Our packaging also, it's intelligent. They all have a unique ID. So we know who used it, how many times it's been used, where it's been used. And we use this to collect information from our users. And our users are quite keen to answer to any questions that we pose them. They're not just users. They don't just like us. They really want to improve Repack, and they love it. So, for example, Net Promoter Score being one of the measures that we use, is if you look at a company like Apple, for example, and quite often people recommend Apple products to others, Apple's Net Promoter Score is 64. Ours is 69. That tells us we've discovered something that people really, really like. We also work with our web stores quite closely. So we collect information how Repack users behave there. And we've discovered that the people who use Repack are your best customers. They are the ones the most valuable to you. And you don't really want to send them trash then. You want to serve them the best possible way. But one of the best feedbacks we really get is in events like this. For example, in TechCrunch in London 2 weeks ago, I was told by the catering people who worked there and who were standing next to our stand, saying that Repack was the only product they understood. And they were wondering why it wasn't invented before. Thank you.
Thank you for the presentation. I had two questions. I wanted to understand the business model a bit better. Are you kind of leasing the packaging, or what's the economics there?
Web stores pay for us per use, and they usually charge the same amount from the end user, from the consumer. So that makes it free for the web store to use. And when package is returned, the web store gives them a voucher, which web store only pays for Repack when there is a new sale. And we always keep that deposit that's being paid.
Okay, so they're charging, whatever you said, €3 extra.
Yeah.
And that currently is a deposit, and then they're giving a later on a credit, maybe €10. So it's
yes.
kind of a
yes.
So they're kind of funding you in a way, the web stores.
They are. It's a way of creating repeat sales and also getting new sales through our marketplace. So if you buy from one web store, you can use the voucher in a different web store, actually bringing in a new customer to the web store. And €10 fee for a new customer in e-commerce is quite low.
So if I already have bought one of these, I paid my €3, I've had a transaction, and now I'm buying something else, do I buy another €3 and go through the same process again?
Yes.
Okay. Can you just describe for me, if Apple uses this, what will my experience be? So what would it look like? How would it feel? Give me the whole emotional pitch.
Well, we do customized packaging for almost all our customers. We started with fashion because that's the easiest thing to pack. But we are, for example, working with Finnish Post Office and Samsung on electronics packaging. So it can be, well, I should talk to my designers about what the feel and the look of the packaging would be. But we are working with all our customers so that we can actually do customizable packaging in a competitive business model.
Maybe it's just about the total lifetime environmental cost, if you like, that if it's only been used once or twice, then it's probably not beneficial to environment. Or
so once returned, Repack has a smaller carbon footprint than two one disposable packages.
Sorry,
once returned, then it's already more environmentally
friendly.
But
then you send it only once as well. You have to send it at least twice.
Yes.
If you send it only
once. But when
one.
It's returned, then it's sent again.
Okay, so you send it twice, then it's better than sending
two disposable packages.
But then it's two equals two. Am I missing something? I don't. Yeah, okay. Maybe it is. What about the market entry? It seems that you have a lot of footwork to do, to talk to all of those e-commerce sites. Or
yeah.
How are you going to do it?
Well, we started with Finnish companies since we are based here in Helsinki. But we are working with Finnish Post Office, PostNord, which is Danish and Swedish Post, and in discussions with DHL, which is the biggest logistic company, about them sort of selling Repack to their customers, because it's a clear add-on product to any logistics services.
You described the model with a B2C e-commerce approach. Have you thought much about the opportunity for person-to-person commerce, where people might have those around the house to send things back and forth?
Yeah, we've thought about it, yes, and we actually were quite in advanced discussions with Finnish auction sites. But so far, we haven't come up with a business model that would be useful to Repack, be useful to the auction site and to end users.
I'm looking at what you're holding, and there's no, that I see, structural integrity to it, whereas obviously cardboard does have structure. Presumably then it's packed full of peanuts or some other packing material, which at least for me, the box is a convenient place to put it, because otherwise the wind picks up, it goes everywhere. Quick question on how does somebody actually pack that, and they probably need a frame to pack it, I assume, or wouldn't stay open. And then the longer question is, could you walk us through the economics of the life cycle of one of those products in terms of, I don't understand in your presentation how much you get paid for it. I understand the deposit part, but I don't understand where you get paid if you're giving the deposit back. And then what your costs are back and forth. Presumably there's a postage cost, yeah. Sorting, cleaning.
Well, our main cost comes from the return logistics. So manufacturing the packaging is not really an issue. That's why, you know, we can make this really intelligent, because it comes back again and again. But so the main cost comes from the return cost, and for each use, the web stores pay to us. So our actually profit margin is over 50% per use. And your first discussion was about the
packing materials inside.
Right. Yeah. We actually started with our first design was a box. And design-wise, it works fine. But we started working with fashion companies then, so they don't need boxes. They prefer bags. So we have a solution for boxes as well in place.
Thank you.
Are we done? Yes, we are done. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Nippe. Woo! What an audience. Last pitch slot in the finals, and I promised that we'll be making a memorable exit. All right, so we're CosmEthics. We're here to disrupt one of the world's biggest industries, namely the cosmetics industry. My name is Katarina Rantanen. I'm the CEO and founder, and I have over 7 years of industry experience in working with the largest fragrance factories in the world. You might be thinking the app stores, they're about gaming and social content, but we proved otherwise. We launched at TechCrunch 2.5 weeks ago as the only startup from the Nordics. And on our launch day, we knocked off here in Finland the likes of Tinder, Clash of Clans in terms of total downloads. And we were number one in our own category, health and fitness. So it proves that people do care about their health. And I'm going to tell you more about it. On our launch day, we nailed the media. For example, BBC, who selected us to be the one and only exclusive that they recorded backstage at TechCrunch. So people are really interested. Cosmetics is about daily hygiene products. Men and women equally use them, men 6, women 12, daily. Now, what this translates to is a lot of ingredients entering our bodies, easily up to 400 molecules. Now, if you think of consumers, this is a typical ingredient list on the packaging. How many are fluent in Latin? All right? So they're written in Latin or in the molecular name, and picking up, for example, that this particular product has the source of formaldehyde, a known human carcinogen, is not an easy task if you think of a cancer patient like my mother. So we're going to make this simple and easy for users. How many of you in the audience have children? Hands up. All right, quite a few. And when a woman discovers that she's pregnant, that's the one critical incident where they really start to look at the products in front of them and wonder if this is safe for me or for my child. That's why we've created a simple traffic light system to indicate if the product is safe or not. And I'm going to demo it to you. So the spine of the app, and this is a free app, is a barcode reader. So it wakes up the camera in the app, and I'll show you how it works. So you start by clicking on Scan the Barcode. Since it's Movember, I thought, let's pick a shaving gel and have a look at its contents. This particular product has a red alert. You can scroll down all of the ingredients, pick up the red alert, click on it. It has our biochemist link to formaldehyde, so you know it's a carcinogen. And underneath, you have the product recommendations based on the ingredients that are safe for you. Now, the fun thing about this app is that you can make it a tool for yourself. Let's say you care about the marine environment, or you're vegan and you don't want animal-based ingredients in your products. You can customize the alert settings. So what we've done here now is customized and adhered to one of the ready-made lists. So that's the end of the demo. In a number of seconds, you can analyze the products in front of you and understand which ones to pick and which ones to leave. Now, the market opportunity is humongous. Cosmetics industry is one of the biggest in the world. European Union alone is 67 billion euros. That's huge. And coincidentally, for once, it's twice the size of the US market. We benefit, and this is where we've rolled out on, uniform barcode structure, uniform legislation, and a huge market. You're probably wondering about our earnings models. We have two that I'll walk you through. So one of them is affiliate revenue. We make product recommendations based on the safer ingredients, and the likes of Amazon, when we link to web stores, is where people can buy them. That's so-called affiliate revenue. We also have premium content, tailor-made allergen lists, for example. Since it's Movember, we've been handing out free non-toxic shaving gels at our booth today. Please join us at our booth also after the presentation. And I'd like to invite you all to download our app for free on iOS and our test version on Android. We have a super team of both business, technical, biochemistry, and relevant knowledge. And we'd like to say thank you and say no more toxins in cosmetics. Thank you so much.
How complete is the database? Well, by the way, thank you for the great pitch.
Thank you.
How complete is the database for the kind of a European markets and US markets, and how big variations are there between different countries, because I guess that there are different products for different countries.
So how complete is our database, was the question. We started out, we launched 2.5 weeks ago, we had 4,000 products. Now we have 17,000. So we're accumulating it in multiple strategies. One of them is voluntary handover, also based on legislation from manufacturers, retailers, large department stores like Sokos, which did an exemplary handover to us last week. And the other thing is users. So users can submit their products immediately by taking two pictures and submitting it to our database, and it's crowdworked. Our aim is to have it crowdworked in 10 minutes. So right now, our scope with the 17,000 will be roughly 60% of scans are found. And with the crowdsourcing functionality, we aim at kind of a just-in-time delivery to give you an estimate and an answer. Thank you.
Thanks, by the way, for the Movember shout out. If anyone wants to donate on my Movember page, it's DG Pilot.
Thank you.
But on where do you go beyond this? Let's say you're out there with this. What will you do in the next few years? What if somebody actually says carcinogens are illegal and then we don't need this database because?
Well, we have different user preferences. Let's say if you're a vegetarian or vegan, or religious reasons, you don't want to consume certain types of ingredients. For me, a product with Serra Alba, which is beeswax, is completely fine. But for a vegan, it's not acceptable. So that is one example. Or if you have an allergy or another type of a need, we're not just about toxicity, but about another example is microplastics, which are released into the water ecosystems. Fish eat them. When we eat the fish, we eat the plastic that the fish ate. So there's a number of useful cases in which an app like this provides you everyday functionality. And answering the first part of the question, where we aim to be, is really transforming how people buy cosmetics products. So, for example, if you're going to a restaurant, you go on Yelp and you check it out. We want to be in the position where you're about to buy a cosmetics product. Of course, you scan it with our app just to make sure it's according to my user preferences. So that's the goal, that's the vision where we want to be. Hopefully, I answered your question.
Yeah, I actually wonder, I mean, anything with a barcode and ethics attached to it seems like a place to grow to. So I just wonder, you know, shouldn't I be able to scan anything and understand its ethical content?
A lot of people are asking us, for example, will you have this product available for food or clothing, etc. We're not crossing anything out. But the customer uncertainty is greatest in cosmetics at the moment. If you buy a canned soup, it says water on it. It doesn't say aqua. It doesn't have the ingredients in Latin or in the molecular name. So for consumers to really understand what they're buying, even in clothing, it will say cotton wool. But in cosmetics, it says the actual ingredient in Latin. So this functions also as a dictionary in addition to a screening tool.
Yeah, and one last question. What's the revenue? I've saw your revenue model. How much as a, you know, what's your kind of average revenue per download or some kind of metric on your revenue?
So we haven't activated our affiliate or our in-app purchases yet. We're going for the viral growth, and we'll be able to judge somewhere next year, later spring, when we have the affiliate contracts in place, if our hypothesis in our simulations are correct or not.
So I spoke earlier about, as a VC, some of the things that frustrate me in a presentation, and one is what's an addressable market. Your discussion of the market said it's $100 billion, but that has nothing as a fundamental matter to do with what your addressable market is. How do you view your market?
So in theory, anyone with a smartphone and anyone in the European Union who uses cosmetics products is a potential client of ours. And that is how we're addressing the market potential at the moment.
If this were one-on-one, we'd have a long discussion about everyone using it, but you've set a standard in terms of toxicity, which is binary, and everything's toxic in excess. The chemicals that you're mentioning are certainly many of them toxic in excess, but there are presumably standards for their inclusion in the products you're contemplating and for that use. What do you do to address that reality, which is concentration matters?
I'm super thrilled that you asked this. This is something we're developing. So concentration, we've for example, met with the customs lab, and they, for example, pull off a certain percentage of products which does not content doesn't comply with the regulatory maximum limits. And we'll be lab testing to verify the true content. So this is also something that consumers can, when they compare products, they can see, for example, parabens, how large is the content of that particular ingredient, which the law already sets a maximum limit towards.
It does, and unless you're doing batch testing, your numbers are going to be wrong batch to batch because the concentrations at those low levels will vary.
Again, this is something that manufacturers do not have to give to consumers at all, and this is a plan that we're addressing in order to be able to bring metrics into the actual products. As of now, since the law says that you only have to indicate the raw ingredients on the labeling, that's what we're going on from right now. And like I said, we have a biochemist that links alert ingredients with research on the ingredients, but the rest is up to the user also to define how do I want to consume, what is my profile.
To the question of market size, in the US, more people shop at Walmart for food than they do at Whole Foods. So just thinking, do you target people who already really are concerned about what's in their cosmetics, or are you really going to try and go out to everyone who buys?
Like I said in the pitch, the moment that people usually become aware of this is when women learn that they're pregnant. So that is the single critical factor when they really start looking through what products am I consuming, be it food, be it cosmetics product. And that's definitely, if I were to click on and select on niches, the woman in her 30s, aware of health effects is our main target area.
Yeah, that limits the market, obviously, quite a bit. But thanks, Katarina. You are as lovely as ever.
Thank you, Rico.
Well done, well done. I know, I'm bad at this. So my question is actually that the retail is going to e-commerce. So what's, you know, you have this offline service that, you know, scanning. So how do you cope with the online business?
Sorry, did you want an answer on how to cope with the online business?
Yes.
So the affiliate revenue, so linking to, for example, local web shops where the product can be easily reached is the goal. And then in the physical environment.
You first have to scan the product, physical product.
You can also search with a barcode. You can also search within categories. Let's say facial care. You can also search with brands. You don't have to have the physical product. But if you're in a store or if you're at home and you have the physical product, the fastest way is to scan it. It just takes a second or two. Mm-hmm. But there's multiple ways of searching products from our database.
Just a little bit about the revenue as well, or the revenue model that, you know. So you don't have any affiliate, you know, Any touch on the revenue, that how many people of the downloadable apps are, you know, anything on that?
Since we're doing the affiliate contracts at the moment and we are activating them around February, we don't have an answer to that question yet. But there might be multiple revenue models. Just to give you an idea, our competitor in the US, which is an NGO, they get $3 million a year in donations. Again, these are examples of revenue models which we're considering.
Okay. Still. We have time.
Are you focused just on the European market? You mentioned a competitor in the United States. What are they called?
Environmental Working Group.
A very unfriendly name.
It's a marketing, you know. All right, are we done? Thanks, Katarina.
Thank you so much. Enjoy Slush.